In this lecture, I will explain the concept of multiple testing, why it is a problem, and how you can correct for it. Let's start with a very simple example, a six-sided die. If we assume the die is fair, then the chance of any particular outcome is 1 in 6, because there's 6 different faces of the die. So the chance of getting the value 6 is also 1 in 6. However, if we throw multiple dice, or if we throw a single die multiple times, then we have multiple chances of getting a 6, and therefore the chance of getting at least 1 6 will increase. This is very important to keep in mind, because the same applies to significance testing. Namely, when you perform multiple hypothesis tests, then each can result in a false positive. Thereby, the overall chance of at least one false positive will also increase. Of course, there could also be many false positives. There is a very simple correction for this, which is called the Bonferroni correction, which I will discuss first. Then I will discuss a more powerful correction based on the false discovery rate. When you are dealing with a very large number of hypothesis tests, like hundreds or even thousands, there are better alternatives, like the local false discovery rate, but this is beyond the scope of this lecture. To understand the corrections and why they work, let's start with a brief recap of hypothesis testing. Suppose we have two groups and we want to know if, on average, they are significantly different. First, we start by setting alpha, the level of significance, and this is actually the acceptable chance of a false positive. So if we set alpha to the commonly used value of 0.05, then that means that we accept a 5% chance of getting a false positive. Next, we assume the difference to be 0, which is the null hypothesis. Then we collect evidence against the null hypothesis, and this is your sample. From the sample, we calculate the sample means and the difference between them, and then we calculate the standard error of the difference. From these values, we can determine a p-value, which we usually do using software. And when the p-value is lower than the chosen level of significance alpha, we reject the null hypothesis. So therefore, a low p-value just means that there is a significant difference in the sample, but the sample is not of interest. We are interested in the population that the sample came from. And there's always a chance that the sample is actually significantly different, while the groups are, on average, the same in the population. And this chance is equal to alpha. Next, let's recap the meaning of the p-value, because it has a very strange meaning that is very important to get right. Namely, the p-value is the chance of observing a difference from the null hypothesis at least as extreme as the one in your sample, if the null hypothesis were in fact true. So that means that if the null hypothesis is true, and there is no difference in the population, there's actually still a chance of p that if you draw a sample from the population, you will find a difference as extreme as the one in your sample. This uncertainty is inherent to any field of science involving observations or experiments. You can never be sure about a population just by looking at a sample. This has a very big implication for multiple testing, because just like rolling the dice several times, if you test multiple hypotheses with the same data, then the chance of at least one extreme result, or one low p-value, is actually much larger than p, and thereby the chance of a false positive grows unacceptably large. Let's start with the most simple interpretation of this problem and the correction for it. This is called the family-wise error rate, and it assumes that there are no differences at all in the population among all the tests that we perform. If we assume this, then the chance of at least one false positive is 1 minus 1 minus the chosen level of significance to the power of the number of tests. So k is the number of tests in this formula, and alpha the chosen level of significance, like 0.05 for example. If we have one test and we have an acceptable false positive rate of 0.05, then we plug in the numbers and we see that the result is the usual 5%. But if we have 5 tests and we plug in the number 5 for k, we see that this chance grows to 22.6%, or more than a 1 in 5 chance of getting a false positive. The simplest correction is called the Bonferroni correction, which controls the family-wise error rate by multiplying each p-value by the number of tests k. This is actually the same as dividing the level of significance by the number of tests k. And when we see this formula, it implies that if we divide alpha, the level of significance that we chose, by the number of tests, then the family-wise error rate, so the chance of at least one false positive among all our tests, is guaranteed to be equal to or less than the chosen level of significance. In other words, the chance of at least one false positive is guaranteed to be at most the level that you chose, which is what we want. For example, if we have 5 tests and we have an alpha value of 0.05, then we simply divide 0.05 by the number of tests 5, and we end up with a value that is close to or less than 5%. The Bonferroni correction guarantees that the chance of a false positive is less than alpha, but it is very strict. If you multiply all your p-values by k, then more subtle differences may never be picked up as significant, especially if you do a large number of tests. After all, the Bonferroni correction is based on the assumption that there are no differences in the population, or that all null hypotheses are true. If there are actual differences between the groups in the population, then Bonferroni is too strict, and it can result in too many false negatives. So just as a small recap, a false positive is when we reject the null hypothesis, even though in the population the null hypothesis is true, or there is no difference between the groups, for example. A false negative is the exact opposite. It is when we fail to reject the null hypothesis, even though it is not true in the population. A perfect correction would prevent as many false positives as possible, while also preventing too many false negatives. One alternative that tries this is FDR correction. And in particular, I'm going to discuss what is called the Benjamini-Hochberg procedure. It works as follows. Order all your p-values from low to high. Then denote the rank of each p-value I. So that means that the most significant p-value gets rank 1, the second most significant p-value rank 2, etc. Then we calculate the corrected p-values by looking at the ith original p-value and multiplying it by the number of tests and dividing it by the rank. Then we restore the original order by saying that each p-value must be at least as low as the p-value after it, because we ordered them from low to high. The Benjamini-Hochberg procedure is a form of false discovery rate correction, and the logic behind false discovery rate correction is as follows. If many variables are actually significant, then surely there must be some true effects. And therefore, the actual chance of a false positive is probably much lower than the family-wise error rate would suggest. The p-values are therefore multiplied by a fraction of k instead of just multiplying everything by k. The most significant p-value has rank 1, so it is still multiplied by the original value of k. So in other words, it is still as strict as the Bonferroni correction. Therefore, it should be as good as the Bonferroni correction while leaving more significant results. In R, there is a very simple function in the package stats, which comes pre-installed with R, called p.adjust. So in this example, I have denoted 3 p-values, one of 0.2%, one of 2%, and another one of 2%. And then I perform a Bonferroni correction like this, and an FDR correction like this. And when we look at the values that have been stored in these vectors, we can see that the Bonferroni correction and an alpha of 0.05 yields only one significant result, while the FDR correction sees that, okay, this one is still significant after correction, so therefore the penalty must go down. And these two also remain significant. Now you might be wondering, if FDR is better than Bonferroni, why would you ever use Bonferroni? And the first reason is, of course, that it is very simple. FDR correction cannot always be done with this procedure, for example when tests are correlated, and Bonferroni is always valid. If you care more about preventing false positives than false negatives, you definitely want to use Bonferroni, because it is very strict on the number of false positives. And if you have more than enough observations to see a significant effect, then why not use Bonferroni, because you're sure you're on the right side. Also, if your effects of interest are very large and very consistent, then your p-values will be very small, and even after a correction as strict as Bonferroni, you will still see the effects of interest, and they will be significant. On the other end, if you want to minimize false positives while also preventing false negatives, then FDR correction is better. And especially if you have a limited sample size or the effects of interest are not very large or not very consistent, then FDR correction might point to the few subtle differences that you cannot pick up when you use Bonferroni. That concludes all for this lecture.